Okay. Oof. So, Tharos, by the request of your good friend Zanwarn, you were summoned here, and I do mean that literally, by a spell, in a magic teleportation circle. You were summoned by your good friend, or at the request of your good friend Zanwarn, to come aid him in the gnomish city of Blingdenstone. You've heard stories of Blingdenstone having fallen hundreds of years ago. You were actually alive during that time, and you've heard about the prosperity beforehand. And you were teleported here, and by the small gnomish guide, you arrived at a large set of stairs, and going towards the city.
Yeah, I follow my gnomish guide.
Cool. Your gnomish guide continues up these stairs. As you get closer, you start feeling like you're being watched. Like eyes are kind of peering at you.
Can I use my elven senses to...
You sure can. Give me a perception check with advantage.
Okay.
Because you're an elf, you get advantage.
Can you explain advantage really quickly?
Advantage means you get a roll twice and take the higher result.
Okay.
Yeah. And that would be a wisdom check plus one because you have perceptionist. No, you don't have perceptionist skill. So just a wisdom check. Okay, so 1d20 plus whatever your wisdom modifier is. Yep, yeah, your wisdom is a 14, so you get a plus 2. 7. Well, good thing you have advantage, you get a roll again.
Okay, and again.
18, back. Beautiful. You start looking up and you see these, you see some bowmen standing above you, with their tiny short bows. These people appear to be similar to your guide. They are most likely, rock gnomes, or Snurf Neblin. As they're called.
Okay, do I think I'm about to be waylaid by rock gnomes?
That would probably be an insight check, but it would be a very basic check to tell that they're most likely just guards.
Okay.
Yeah. Your gnomish guide's getting some distance on you up the stairs.
I hurry after him.
Cool. You continue up until eventually you get to about here, where you can actually see... over top. Eventually you see from across the way with a large man standing in front of an even larger door made of iron and barred. You see it is your good friend Zanwarn, the priest of Bahamut.
That is working to flip this cart back over again. For a second time, I swear they're going around this corner way too quickly.
you notice that some safety signs have been put up. Do not turn as quickly here. And despite that, these guys are still turning far too fast. The wheels are not designed to do as they do. And as they do, you see another little keg as Zanwarn's holding with two hands start kind of rolling down this way.
Oh, I try to catch it for him.
Oh, yeah, sure.
And I say, how'd it work or how'd they working, Zanwarn?
Wait, what?
Busy. Fixing kegs.
Oh, very busy. Fixing kegs, killing undead, ducking, lots of ducking. Have fun.
yeah, you see Zanwarn is actually carrying a small case on him. He would reveal later that's actually filled with silver from a previous reward, about 333 pieces. You can guess who got the uneven one piece.
Mm-hmm. Well, come on inside. We've got lots of work to do. I assume like the orcs aren't attacking anymore or something like that.
Who are you asking?
DMOOC.
You get no response.
Okay. I'm fine with that.
Yeah. You're asking Bahamut, and he is silent.
I don't get reception down here. It's very difficult.
The door's open. You see some guards standing there, as well as a path before you.
That's right. We got to go through the fun labyrinth.
I let Sanward lead the way.
This guy says, "Are you sure you want to go in there?" He says, good call. Good call on that. I'm just going to copy you. Good. You are copied. Delete. And because you guys were about to get waylaid if you actually went in there by yourselves. Like, destroyed. It is filled with traps. Like, so many. Actually, as you're going through, with your superior perception, Tharos, I was going to call you Dungeon. With your superior perception, you actually notice in the distance, kind of on a corner, while you're within the labyrinth, there is a rather large and ornate chest, just kind of sitting in the middle of the labyrinth.
Okay, does anyone else seem to notice this chest?
Zanward and the gnome both seem to not see it. It's a little bit in the distance, probably about 10, 15 feet.
I take a moment and stop, and I say, what about this chest yonder here?
What chest? I didn't see a chest.
He kind of points out, and you see there is a chest in the distance. It's ornate. You see it's kind of got some gold filing or gold trim to it. Very, very good looking chest.
I came personally to spread the wealth of Bahamut. If you want to open the chest, I'll be behind you in case you spring a trap.
I asked the gnome if he has noticed this chest before as I slowly walk towards it.
He looks over and you see him actually get frightened by seeing the chest. And he kind of looks to you and whispers, there are no such treasures here. Only dangers. We must continue on our way. And you kind of hear then in the distance kind of like a sound. Sounds very similar to... very similar to this.
So the orcs aren't done yet. Okay.
you hear that within the labyrinth, kind of echoing. You don't know if that's orc. You give me a nature check if you want to see if you can recognize for this. I know for a fact that one of you does. So, Thyros, why don't you give me an intelligence check? It would be 1d20 plus 4 because you have 3 intelligence and you have a 1 proficiency in nature.
Sure.
Oh, 15. You can tell easily that this sound comes from a minotaur.
Oh, yeah. Labyrinth, Minotaur. Yeah, that's...
I stop heading towards the chest and say, this hasn't been cleared out, has it?
He says that the Minotaur is part of the labyrinth. He only guards a certain section.
I say, very well, lead on.
He nods, and you guys eventually get past. As Zanward kind of sticks behind just a little bit, and he takes one last look at the treasure chest, and you see it seems to be like smiling with the lid open, and these kind of jarred gnawing teeth kind of reveal themselves.
A mimic. Okay. Oh, for the future, I would recommend not telling anyone about the Twitch account, because I have another tab on the Twitch account. I can see the way through the labyrinth.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. And I recognize that. I assume that if you guys wanted to play, if you want to play that way, I can make it a lot harder.
No, I've actually closed that account now that I've noticed that. The only tab I have is this now.
Yeah. If you guys were to like watch the video and come back here, you still wouldn't be able to get through the labyrinth. But
this would be my last time of doing this because I work night shifts.
Oh yeah, so. Cool, no problem. So the gnomish guide eventually leads you through.
Okay.
You guys get to the other side, and he's kind of tired. He's kind of an old guy. He kind of just tells you to go on without him. It's just ahead of you.
It is. Just follow me. I should have my light source on.
Okay, cool. You turn the light source on. Bloop, bloop.
Oh. There you go.
And Thyros, you should play follow.
I follow Zanward. Yay, light.
He's got all sorts of music like this, trust me.
It's true. You should, when you're looking at this tape, if you look at the tape, you can just see how many I actually have. I'm scrolling through them right now. It's just tons. Yep. And you kind of hear a sound from far above you. Sounds like an oi!
Oh, it's Bronze Bottom. I don't remember his first name. His last name is Bronze Bottom.
That's true. His last name is Bronze Bottom.
Bronze Bottom.
First name, uncreative. I'm ready. Damn this music.
What are you doing up there? He's not in here yet, is
he? I'll, No, he's in.
I'm here.
Just a little quiet. You are right here, buddy.
Yep.
13 HP, 15 AC. You look down at your friends entering in, or your friend, and a new mysterious stranger.
Is that an elf?
It is an elf.
It would be.
Is that a dwarf?
It is a dwarf, yes.
Come down to take a closer look at this elf going underground.
Give me a climb check. These are very tiny stairs. Nah, you're fine. You slide down with vigor and then just kind of hop off. Everything is tiny here, Zanward.
Yeah, eh? Hey, where did you find this one now?
I knew him on the surface. We've been on things together. We're not going to discuss this.
That sounds vaguely sexual.
Well, there was this one time with the succubi.
Stays in the dungeons of Las Vegas.
Now I have to make a place called Las Vegas.
The Dungeons of Los Viejos.
Okay, cool. What do you guys do?
Well, I guess if you know him, you're here for money too, Thyros.
Wow.
Talk to me, Thyros.
Greetings, friend dwarf.
Hi.
Okay. So I hear there is many opportunities in these caves.
Oh, there are. Hey, Zanward. Does this mean I need to carry this weakling with me? Now?
No, he can carry himself for the most part.
Sure, whatever.
Yeah, I'm just going to take a moment to give some exposition just so Thyros understands where he is. Wherever you look, you can see there's these little doors leading into parts of the rock. And, the rock seems to be clear skyward just for hundreds and hundreds of feet from beyond what your light can possibly see. And even the dim light that comes off it, you can't see the top. It just goes on seemingly forever. It's a, you getting down here, you assumed, although you were teleported, you assume you're deep in the Underdark, which is, hundreds of miles below ground level, below surface level.
Okay.
And, you you expect that if you were to walk out, you would not, if you were to try walking out, you would not see the sun for weeks.
A dismal place.
And this is apparently a building that has sprung a leak. So don't ask what kind of building it was. There are many treasures to be found down here. One in particular, we have an axe. Some magical axe.
Oh, I'm just going to say real quick. Brunar, is that? Yes, Brunar. You would have on you a small case with about 333 silver coins.
Small case, yes.
Yeah, small case.
You remember where the tavern is.
Well, let's go for beer, I guess. Onward! Follow me.
He's probably going to buy 3 kegs. And I don't mean cups, I mean kegs. I go the shorter route.
I follow.
After a brief moment, you guys find each other again. Wow, Brunar kind of hustles so he gets there first, so he doesn't look like a fool. You see the areas covered with people. They're all very busy, eating, drinking, making merriment. You guys can see there's an unguarded area right down here. There appears to be, despite this place being sieged by orcs constantly, there are no guards there. Yeah. So you approach the bartender?
Have a sit, I'll bring the drinks.
He laughs and he gives you a tray of ale. And he says, are the others gonna want any?
Yeah. I'm not. I'm gonna try to stay sober.
Yeah. You can see he actually has supplied a bucket this time for you.
Perfect. I like the innkeeper.
A bucket to fill
and the keg.
Is this a bucket to fill with ale or a bucket to sit on because we can't sit on any of the chairs?
He shrugs and says, whatever you want.
Bruno quickly snaps the bucket. So, takes it, I mean.
Yeah,
and return to my table.
The same table.
Yes, it is the same table.
Okay, so Brunar is trying to find a way to sit down. And Zandvar kind of sits Indian style, like he's, yeah. And Tharis, you're kind of looking at this table. It's very small, it's low to the ground. The seats are half the size it would need to sit in for you.
I will also sit upon the ground, Indian style.
Cool. You sit Indian style, very cold stone ground. And do you partake in the drink?
Yes, I wouldn't want to be rude.
Cool. So you partake in the drink and you begin discussing plans.
Well, to put it quickly, what we have found is almost like a necropolis down beneath here in the B word, whatever it was called. We also have... Yeah, it's amazing. I actually wrote stuff down, and the name of the campaign was not one of them.
Oh, Blingdenstone. Reclaiming Blingdenstone.
We also heard stories of elementals on the loose. Something about Intramat's, them attacking Intramat's boon Or I could have that wrong. It's a giant elemental called Intramat's Bane.
Orgrimmar.
Orgrimmar, okay. I knew I was going to screw something up. And supposedly this witch that gave our halfling this magical axe.
You would assume you have the axe on you until he gets back.
Okay. I'm gonna assume I have the axe. That loaned us this axe. I wanted us to kill this, so that's kind of high on my priority list. We also have, if you look directly behind me around this direction, which he might not be able to see, it's too dark, but I'm going to point that way anyways, the singing stones, which haven't been spoken in. Apparently the gods communicated to these people hundreds and hundreds of years ago, and they used... And it's silent for some reason. I don't know. I didn't have a very high art religion check on this, but.
Well, that's the how you'd say it in the world. My religion check was poor. No.
I don't know shit about these. I'm used to, you know, the elven gods and, you know, the. I don't know much about these little people gods.
It's true, the deities of creatures from the Underdark so far away would be very obscure for him.
I wonder if my training in the Arcane would tell me anything about these elementals.
Ooh, give me a roll. 1d20 plus 4.
Okay.
From his description, you would definitely recognize these as earth elementals, or elemental stone, granite, even like cement and things of that nature. They are known to be very large, very deadly. Similar to, but not, a little different than Brunar, than dwarves.
So it seems like it'd be a fairly common thing, and not, you know, special elementals or anything like that, just regular depths of the earth.
Elementals are still relatively rare. You have heard long ago of Entremach's Boon and how they learn to basically coax and make elementals more powerful within Blingdenstone. And you know that an enchantment like that would be very powerful. And very, very pricey.
I asked you, you said the witch wanted us to destroy this boon?
She wants us to destroy the elemental. Oh, no. Hold on. What was it?
Yeah, that's about right.
Okay.
Destroy the elemental. Destroying the boon would be bad. Brunner said as he looks suspiciously at
the guy. You're a little quiet there, buddy.
Yeah, sorry. The stranger is
much better.
Going worse and worse in his mind. An elf and a wizard! Great.
It is great, isn't it?
No, not really.
That means if I wasn't here, you'd be drinking alone.
Brunner's face gets a little red.
I guess we need a wizard, anyway, for the elementals.
That's why I called him, because we didn't have a wizard before. We didn't know crap, so I brought an expert.
He's an expert now.
We would still be up for a fierce fight. These elementals are beings of pure stone, makes dwarfs look soft.
That's why we don't take them for granted.
So many puns.
For dwarves. So, I should buy a pickaxe, I guess, and abandon my axe.
Do I know any traditional weaknesses of elementals or rock elementals?
Magic.
Magic? Okay.
Anything, as long as my axe goes through them and kill them, it's okay. Don't worry, poor elf.
Look, I finished my beer and I said, so how long are we gonna sit here before we get to the actual...
Well, we can go whenever you are rested.
Do I need to do anything to prepare spells or anything like that? Or
No, you're all ready to go.
I'm ready to go. I finish my beer and I slam it down.
Cool. And Brunar finishes his bucket of ice too as he places it down. Yeah, it's you can put it in your backpack if you want to. Perfect. Okay. So what do you guys do?
I believe we head west, I think it was, towards the Bane. I believe it was west.
That's your plan.
Alright.
Sandward teleporting around.
Yes.
Leading Thyros and Brunar in the dark.
I can't even teleport, but I mean, I can't polymorph either, and all of a sudden I'm a human.
You're human by popular demand, and I'm the popular one. You get to here, and you guys start to be able to see beyond there, and you are stopped by this small gnome. It says you cannot go any further.
Why not?
There are dangerous elementals beyond.
That is what we are here to cure.
It says, cure, how do you intend? So he asks questioningly.
Axes, magic, hammers, the usuals.
He shakes his head and says, I couldn't let you pass. Anyone who attacked even one of the elementals was attacked by all of them at once. We've sent entire crews of gnomes in, and they all got slaughtered.
We aim to go after the Bane itself.
He kind of crosses his arms and says, I couldn't let you in without proper authorization. He says, this is for your own safety.
We might have to go.
Come on already. And we can... knocks at the door.
Okay, sure.
We can either just push him out of the way, or we can go talk to the warden. And the warden's probably grateful he's not wearing aluminum foil right now, and might let us have something to go past these.
Okay, Bruno, you knock the door?
Yes.
Or we could talk to her.
Okay. A little slit opens up, it closes, and then the door opens. And you see the little woman again. It says, greetings, welcome back, dwarf. Have you taken the monster down yet?
Yeah, we were on the way, but these morons say we need permission. Is that from Warden?
She says, well, permission, she kind of itches her head. Well, we can probably get past that somehow, but you guys wouldn't be able to take it down anyway. You would require help.
Yeah, we found the wizard.
She kind of looks past your large armor. She says, well, I was thinking some more help. These unless he's a grand wizard of the earth elementals.
Grand wizard.
She kind of twists her head. She says, "Well, then you'll definitely need help from someone more capable." She kind of points this way. She says, "In the old forges, creatures have taken up residence. They call themselves—they're called the Pecks. They are not friendly to us, but they're also not hostile. Perhaps you could coax them into assisting us."
Sure.
That's right. I forgot about the Pecks.
Wicked Pecks.
Says onward. Let's get going.
We're going to go see the warden?
No. This old lady here says we need more help than your weak friend.
She gets easily offended when you call her an old lady.
Runor doesn't really care.
She's gonna close the door on you then.
Does she still think we need to get those pecs? I really think we could handle this on our own.
Last thing she said was, "You're gonna need the pecs or you'll die."
Yes, but I didn't hear that, and I was just remembering from yesterday and I have an ego complex.
Well,
I step in to say we should get all the allies we can. Earth elementals are fearsome creatures.
Well,
fine.
Allies is fine, as long as they don't get my share.
Alright, so are they were to the east, so we gotta go the other side of town.
They were in a specific place, you could ask.
Oh. It was just pointed in a direction. Alright.
Well, she said where they had taken up residence.
So are they like in town?
Well, this is a city that's okay. Being slowly reclaimed, so everything takes place within the city.
Okay, I understand why that was a stupid question now. Alright, so... Oh, hello. There we go.
Go on.
Okay, so... It's by the old forges. Which, this is where the warden is, who is no longer wearing aluminum foil. And if we turn this way, we are at... I am trying to remember. The old forges were somewhere this direction.
It was literally yesterday.
It was literally yesterday, yes. I want to say it was south. No, because what south is bar.
Now you guys can see these guys training by stabbing a large orc-looking figures.
And you may see a couple with like a scimitar that's just way too big for them.
Those were machetes.
Okay. Where was the old forge?
One of the gnomes. Oi! Where were the old?
I see one kind of stabbing into a guy and kind of turn back and you say, "What?
Where were the old forge again?"
He points right there.
Oh, okay. That makes things simple. Alright. Let's go over here.
You see this guy kind of stop and say, "Whoa, where do you three think you're going?"
Everyone's always stopping us. What's with the... They think this place is dangerous or something. It's not like, you know, Brenner went into negative HP and...
You look at Brenner and you can see he's not really wearing a helmet, and you can see this large scar going from the tip of his skull to the back. He questions, what are you guys doing? It's dangerous back here.
We're looking for the help of the pecs.
He kind of questions, says, the pecs? How? Why would they help us?
Well, we were trying to stop the Earth Elementals from ravaging the west side. And the pecs don't have to necessarily know that we are working with you. We just have to have them help us.
This is, okay. Just watch out. Kind of step aside.
And I pretty much just, like, step over that.
Yeah. And Bruno has a little bit of trouble because he's pretty short.
Alright.
You guys get to hear, and what kind of music? How about mystery game?
Bruno returns and asks over the barricade, was it north or south again?
North. You'll notice it right away.
That's nice.
As you guys enter in, you can quickly see just stalagmites and stalactites going from up to very top to the bottom. It's just covered with them. It looks like this area has never been
cultivated.
Never been cultivated. Yeah. As you enter in, you start to see images of small creatures, kind of shadows, just kind of appear and then duck behind the stalagmites and stalactites.
Sex again.
What was that?
What are these creatures we're looking for again?
Pets.
I don't know what that is, but okay.
It's just the name of the creature. They are earther and elementals.
Uh huh.
Bruno is a competent enough fighter to know that in this kind of area it would be very difficult to fight. All of this would be rough terrain. And yeah, anything with a stag types in would be difficult to cross.
Okay, and because you had mentioned that at a very odd point, I'm going to metagame here and probably stick to the edges.
Cool.
Bruno, as he follows, oi, where are those acts?
You continue to see shadows kind of dart in and out in the far distance.
Now, are these and this, are those bones?
Where? No, that appears to be shattered wood. You assume it's from some sort of ancient door.
Okay. I guess I'm going to keep going north.
I ask my companions if there's usually creatures running about here.
Well, we've seen zombie orcs. But other than that, and some, I think there were bats. I have not seen much down here.
Well, these little creatures running around, I don't know. Is this the pecs we're looking for? Oi, little guys, come out.
Should we do a knowledge nature roll to know if these are pecs?
After a short amount of time, you see something in the distance kind of stay in the light. See, it looks very similar to this.
Oi.
Okay. This way. I'm going to try to step in front of Brainier and bring up my holy symbol.
Cool. Of Bahamut, the Platinum Dragon.
Bahamut, the Platinum Dragon. And I say, we come seeking advice and assistance.
He says, The hoop hoods, who are you?
I am Zanward of a prince or a cleric of Bahamut. We seek to stop the blah 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 bane. Blah 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 bane.
He says he's never heard of blah 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 bane.
The Intramat's bane.
Do you mean Ogamark's bane? He asks.
Let me rewrite that. Yes, Ogamark's pain. I'm sorry, I have horrible issues.
He asks if you'd like him to spell it for you.
Go ahead.
You see him kind of disappear into the stone.
Okay. He apparently disappears into the stone.
As if he was becoming melded and became one with it.
I missed the last.
It appears that the creature, it kind of melded into the stone.
Hey, where did you go? Start poking around.
After a brief time, Thanos, with a superior perception, noticed it reappear behind him. He says, your people, the gnomes, they've put barricades between us and them, as if we're going to attack them. How would we possibly help you and them?
We are not here on behalf of the gnomes. We are here on behalf of all that have been ravaged. We are here to seek vengeance on those that have been killed by, or those that have killed Bahamut's servants. Am I going to have to roll like a deception check or something?
Are you saying that meaningfully?
I'm probably lying.
You're going to need to do a persuasion check just because you're saying it so poorly.
I think because I don't think there are many Bahamut followers down here. That's charisma.
Yeah, it would be charisma. Plus persuasion, if you have the skill, you can add plus one.
I do not.
Cool. Oh, but it doesn't matter. He kind of nods and he says, saving our fallen brothers is very important. Or, not saving them, but, what's the word? Honoring them. Honoring our fallen brothers.
Okay, we could probably go back and chill at the bar.
Wait,
is he going to help us? Oh, so he's helping us?
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay. Maybe take a 5-minute bathroom break so you can get William situated?
Sure.
Okay.
Okay, hey William, you should get in the...
Skype call.
You should get into the Skype call.
I'm gonna go walk my dog while we're doing this, so I don't have to do that.
Pretty sure he's doing drugs. That was loud.
John, sorry for coming late.
Oh, no problem, buddy.
I was actually sleeping and missed all the messages.
That's no problem.
Just until this Skype call.
Yeah, that's no problem. I'm just going to grab pre-made.
In any case, I remember most of my character attributes unless something is changed.
Yeah, yeah. You'll be fine. One shot. Boom.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey, buddy. Ooh, echoes.
Yeah, I hear it as well.
Okay, cool. So yeah, what kind of character were you planning on playing?
Whatever pre-mades were available.
Okay, cool. Let's go grab one then.
Really new.
Oh, okay. What is good? How do you feel about a half-elf bard?
Yep, that's good with me.
Cool. What kind of name do you think would be appropriate for you?
Does it have to sound like anything in specific?
Not really.
All right. Turgle will be all right.
Turgle the Turtle.
Yep.
Okay, cool. If you look into the handouts, you will see the name Turtle, and they'll have all your stats and things like that nature.
Oh, all right. Thank you.
No problem. On you, you would have a short bow, and a pair of short swords. And you have a guitar or flute on you. I'm gonna go ahead and grab a character for you.
Hey, William.
Hey, how's it going?
Could you please turn your microphone in the roll 20 off? That's what's causing the
feedback.
Yeah, just got it.
Sweet.
Oh, this gives me time to prepare my macros again, I guess.
If you'd so please. Okay, Turgle, which is now what I'm going to call you. You are you're a half-elf. You made the long journey down, miles and miles underground. To the city of Blingdenstone, where you knew there would be lots of treasure, and they were trying to revive a city, so there's lots of opportunity there. You actually came delivering a large amount of wood, which you made just a gigantic profit from. You started investing and buying up houses so you could sell and fixing them out, and you started making more profit. But at the point you're at, you're basically just sitting on investments and waiting for them to turn into cash or silver.
All right.
That sounds something like you would do.
Yeah. I can get with that.
You can pick up what I'm laying down.
Yep.
Cool. Pennington? I don't know who Pennington is.
Oh, okay. Do you remember Extreme Home Makeover?
Oh, no.
No, okay.
Oh, was it that blonde guy who was like, hey, yeah, welcome to the family? Yeah, essentially.
That was
only a greedy version. Half-elf, probably born of an elvish father who was very prolific. And you have a lot of half-brothers just everywhere.
At first, I didn't know what the word prolific means, but now I think I have an idea.
banging. So yeah. So is everyone here? Brunnar, Zanwar, Dungeon?
Yep.
Cool. Okay, let's continue. Note, he will not be in the bar, but you will find him.
Uh-huh.
Okay. But yeah, you should definitely just continue on. Like, you never knew he was... He existed.
All right. So, I wish, you know, I would like to avenge the fallen followers of Bahamut by destroying Agrimmar's Bane.
They nod. They say we can help you with this. But they say if we were to do this, the gnomes would still be their gnomes. They would try to come in here and enter our area, and they would try to reclaim the forges and turn this area back from how they made it before. They say it took them 100 years to get into this position, and they would just come back in here and ruin it again.
I speak up and say, we're not working for the gnomes. We could just lie to them. We won't tell them that the area is cleared out. You get extra space and you give us some help so we can get rid of these little rock dudes.
He raises an eyebrow and he says, the Hall of Miners, which is kind of, he points over to the area where they exist, the Ogamox Bane. He says that the elementals there are quite powerful. We'll be able to sedate them, but when it comes to Ogamark's Bane, he's too powerful. You will need to destroy him yourself. We can offer you protection, but he will still be very hard to defeat.
As long as you can keep us from being swarmed by the little ones, this should work out fine.
He says that he's an elemental of gravel, and he can create a great wind of rock. But he says, very well, but we will assist you.
Thank you. All right, so we need to now get to Agrimmar's Bane.
They nod. Say we can get through the north.
Okay.
You see a bunch of these packs form out, and they kind of form.
Oh yay! That's what I always wanted, an army of my own.
They say we can go to the north and to get there, but we must be wary. The orcs are known to be through there.
Now, these actual orcs are... Oh, they won't know. Never mind.
Now I feel silly. I got my microphone closed.
That is silly.
Okay.
Orcs? Orcs are here.
They say it's on the opposite end of the area in the west.
So we need to go west. Okay.
Yep. You guys look down and you see a barricade here, and the pecs seem to kind of back off from that. They don't want to go where the gnomes are.
That's fine. We can go this way and hopefully, you know, no orcs. Okay, it's not 10. I know what that rule is.
I know what you would know what the rule is. You just don't know that in the city is different than out here.
Okay.
Cool. I'm just going to look up my little chart here. And the little chart says that when I get an 8. Interesting. Okay, so it's at this point you guys kind of hear some stuff. It sounds like skittering.
I would like to have my warhammer and my shield out.
Cool. You see these guys get pretty scared. They kind of huddle together.
I ready my axe and start looking around. I don't know.
Give me a perception check.
And that's wisdom, right?
Yes. Probably.
Perfect.
Okay, yeah, you don't see anything particular. Besides shadows moving all around you. And the scream of orcs.
The scream. Okay, so the sound we heard was orcs?
You definitely hear orcs in the distance over this way.
Alright.
It kind of echoes through.
I call Brainerd to come up front and Thyros to stay behind the pecs. That way we have the pecs protected. And hopefully we won't get ambushed.
So you continue to hear the sound coming from over here.
Okay. So I'm going to go in first because last time we had Brainerd go in first and that apparently did not work out very well.
Cool.
No, we had the rogue go in first, and that really didn't work well.
No. Thyros is having a little trouble seeing where he is. It's a little far away.
Okay.
No, he is doing pretty good. He can see about this much with your light because he's got low light vision.
Well, that's.
Yep.
So I'm gonna take another step, which means Thyros is soon gonna just go blind.
Yeah. So that's when you kind of hear something falling from the roof.
Alright. I think now might be a good time for me to do a perception check.
It's a good call.
I think it's only a 2. Hold on. Word 15, so that's a 2.
Nice. You look behind you, as where you heard kind of got tick and you don't see anything.
Alright.
Can I move the picks and myself to the kind of bottom wall there, 3 squares beneath Brunar?
Sure, here?
Yeah, thereabouts, yeah.
That's Tharos when you feel something on your shoulder kind of just land.
What's on my shoulder, pray tell?
As you look over it, you see a very large centipede. It kind of hisses and then goes for a bite.
I scream like a little girl and try to get it off me.
Cool. So it's gonna take a quick bite. Let's see what kind of damage it does. Ooh, that's gonna hurt you. It doesn't attack, it gets a 17. If your armor wasn't already 13, it would really be easy. Okay, it does 1 point of damage to you. What's your constitution, 1?
My constitution is... Plus 1.
Plus 1, okay. Give me a constitution saving throw. That's 1d20 plus 1. You have to roll 1d20 plus 1.
Or put it in double brackets.
Cool. So you take 1 point of damage as this thing kind of bites into your neck. And then, in addition to that, I'm just going to subtract once you're at 6 health now, you kind of feel some poison trying to course through your body.
I curse an elvish and say, if only I was a dwarf, and try to
fight them. And this is when you notice that they all seem to be falling off of the wooden planks. Okay, and roll for initiative. If you're not aware, your initiative, Thyros, is plus 3. So, 1d20 plus 3.
Well, it wouldn't be interesting if it was always dwarves. When I mean dwarves, I mean orcs. And when I mean orcs, I mean...
And we get more... Oh, somebody got higher than me this time. Congrats. About time.
It's okay, I got lower.
What'd you get, Zand? I didn't see.
I have a 6.
Wow. If there's any consolation, I plan on killing you this game. So they're going to go for you. Definitely two on Brunner, because why not? And these guys are going to go for the pecs. Let's see, one attack. Ugh, right in here. Boom, one attack on you, Zanward. Give me a constitution saving throw.
When is it Thyros' turn?
Continue.
Okay.
A friend just came over and I had to shoo him away. That's right, give me a constitution saving throw, Zanward. And as well as you lose one health. Oh, Brunar is bit twice. And Theros manages to knock it off this time. And
constitution.
Still need another con check? No con check this time. But Bronner, you need two con checks, but you have advantage.
And do I still retain my plus one constitution from the beer buff?
You sure do. Because you drank that big old thing of ale. The others kind of drank, so it really wasn't enough.
So what's the bonus for 17?
It would be 18, so you get a plus 4.
Okay.
Somebody should be rolling. So Brunner, roll again. Sorry, William, but this is the cost of coming in late. You have to be introduced naturally. unfortunately for Brenner, he now has some poison coursing through his veins. In addition to taking 1 point of damage, you now have an AC of 14. And Zanward, did you give me a saving throw?
Oh, I did not realize I needed one. Okay, it says Constitution?
Yep.
Plus one.
Okay,
I am
so
poisoned as well.
You have a Constitution of 17. And Thyros has a Constitution of 12. Oh, wait, he passed last time. Never mind. So yeah, that was fun. Brunar. Oh, wait, no. Oh, Thyros, you're supposed to... Yeah, you... Thyros, you should go first. So go for it.
Okay. I try to get the picks away from the edge of the wooden scaffolding there, and cool. I try to blast the one closest to me with a ray of frost.
Nice. You do have more powerful spells, but whatever. Give me a roll. It would be 1d20 plus 3 plus 1, so 1d20 plus 4. Oh, unfortunately, the spell kind of backfires. Nothing happens. Bruno, you're up.
Bruno will his axe to this one, yelling curses in his dwarfish language.
Awesome. Give me a roll.
We are just having lousy rolls right now.
I'm having great rolls. And this isn't helping the fact your AC is getting reduced each time. The curse returns. Wow, that is a shame, buddy. So Zanward, you're seeing all your allies fail. Do you plan on succeeding?
First thing, I plan on blessing...
Oh, on these guys. You're going to bless on centipedes.
No, hold on. I got to... Well, we might have a rest, aren't we? We got a lot of poison in us, so we're probably going to have to take a rest.
This guy takes a bite at you, and you take one damage and give me a con save.
There you go. Tires.
Okay, so your AC is now 16.
16. Alright. So
these guys are messing you up.
with how the rolls have been going, I'm going to bless everyone, including the picks that might not be fighting. That is a plus 4 on saving rolls and attack rolls.
Is that my breathing you hear?
I am not certain.
I don't know who. It might be. I think it's Altos. Yeah. Stop breathing so hard, Altos.
Just stop breathing.
Shame on you for breathing, buddy.
Yeah. You should not be breathing, ever.
Oh, wait.
You're to be seen and not heard.
It's not a 4 bonus, it's a 1d4
bonus. Yeah, it's extra 1d4, which is very beneficial.
Especially just.
Yeah, so everyone, whenever you make an attack, you can add an extra 1d4. Thyros. It's your turn again.
I continue to cast ineffectually Rays of Frost for everyone.
Awesome. Unless you get a natural 20 in case you kill it. Natural 20 and you kill it. Ho! So yeah, wow, that actually is really good. So give me some damage, which would be 1d8. Yeah, roll 1d8. Okay, yeah, you send an icy blast, and you just see it get sent by sheer force into the wall, and just kind of, it all turns blue and icy, killing it instantly. Do you want to move anywhere?
Away from the scaffolding.
Cool. Giant centipedes. They're going to continue their strikes. These two are going to be on. This first one's on Zanward. It's going to miss. It's going to hit some of his armor. On Brunner, 2 attack. I believe your AC has been turned to 14, so that means both hit. So give me 2 constitution checks there, Brunner. This is against poison, so you do have advantage, so you get to roll twice for each of these checks. You want to succeed on your next one.
Don't they have their 1d4?
Yes, you do get an extra 1d4. So go ahead and roll it. Three. Yeah, you're fine. You're fine on that roll. You win automatically. So give me 2 more rolls for your second poison.
Plus 1d4.
Oh yeah, you're fine again. But you do keep getting bit by these little things. Okay, and yeah, Brunner, you're up.
I'm gonna get you this time, damn it, and attack the same.
Cool. This time actually hit. Oh wait, you have a great axe specialty, so that means that even if you missed, you would have killed it anyway. And with a critical in your next hit, you chop the other one straight in half. Blah. Yeah, remember, even if you miss, you still do your strength and damage.
Yeah, forgot it. Yeah, my strength.
Okay. Zanward, you just see Brunner slaughter 2 in a second.
Well, I got the one next to me and I'm warhammering it. That's a 22. That is not a critical, though.
No, 22, beautiful. Yeah, you just give me some damage. I assume you're just gonna slam
that
it down.
Should have done damage. Okay, hold on. I gotta fix that macro.
Maybe you should just roll damage and then fix your macro. It's gonna be 7. It's 1d8. Beautiful. Yeah, you smash into bits. Blah. Thyros, back to you.
I will continue throwing bolts of frost wildly.
Unfortunately, you shoot too wide. See the giant centipedes begin to retreat and climb back up these things. They eventually get out of your sight. The pecs question your capabilities.
We're fine. I only took one damage.
You took damage this game, didn't you? Okay, so at this point, it kind of gets quiet, and that's when you hear something coming from this direction. It's kind of like a ka-tink, 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 ka-tink.
I'm getting ready. As soon as I see the orcs, I'm gonna charge them.
Roger. If you see an orc, you will charge it. How long do you wait?
How long does the sound... Oh my god. How long does the sound last?
The sound seems to keep going for at least a minute. That's not pleasurable to the ears, whoever's doing that.
How do I mute the guy?
It's not me, it's not me. Yeah. Hey, push the dog on.
Might be Devano. No?
Yeah, it's in the browser.
Ah, sorry, buddy. So yeah, you still hear that tink coming from there. It sounds like metal on stone.
So it could be forge, it could be lots of things. But we're all currently poisoned. Should we have like Brainer and I? No, hold on. You can't see in the dark. I was thinking someone needs to go to town and maybe get some antidotes, and you know maybe pick up William. But
to tink.
I think we should probably press on while we have our allies with us.
They say yeah, we can't go into town, so.
Well, that's why I was thinking like two people could stay with them here and one could go, but Thyros doesn't have.
Boldly walk forward.
Okay. Cool. You hear the katink get louder and louder as you go.
Let me move here.
You see a light up ahead as you go. Yeah.
Oi, onward. You can quickly go back to town and pick us the antidotes. I can hold this narrow passage, I guess. Until you return, that is.
Katink. As you approach, as you approach, you see a half-elf. He appears to be slamming a pick into what appears to be an ancient gnomish altar.
Okay. So it's an altar. So that's. I'm gonna kind of come up since I already have like my shield and axe or my hammer, and the hammer's got some guts on it. You know, I come up and I'm like, what are you doing?
Turgle, for the last little while, you found this thing already, this tablet already smashed up. But you quickly found the reason that it was smashed up is because it has tiny little rubies embedded in it. So you notice that this is already destroyed, people wouldn't be missing it. You might as well take the rubies. So for the past couple of hours, you've been basically taking rubies out, and you have a handful of tiny rubies. Probably worth like 100 silver total. And of course you see a dwarf, a human, a half elf, and about 5 tiny earth monsters following them.
Is what I've gotten so far small enough where I can pick it up?
While you guys are talking, I'm going to use the restroom.
Okay.
But yeah, you guys should introduce each other, yourselves, etc., etc.
Hey, Wickling. Where are the orcsises? You seen any? That's Bruiner, by the way.
I'm going to continue to ignore you and keep whacking away trying to get these rubies. I'm pretending you're not there.
Well, I would do a knowledge or knowledge religion check, but instead, as a priest, I'm going to come up. I'm going to grab you by the collar and pick you up, which means it's a strength contest.
Is
that what you do when you meet people? You just go up and pick them up?
Yes. I've done this once before. Sadly, I actually have.
Well, I properly flip the fuck out and I start flailing everywhere.
And I'm like, do you know what you are doing to this religious artifact?
Do you know what you're doing to my tunic?
I'm hoping the wrinkles would just come right out.
Well, you're doing a fine job at it. Keep going.
How did you even get past the gnomish guards? They don't let any...
Bribery is surprisingly effective.
I bet, and so are rubies.
Yeah, and you know, not picking up someone when you see them and alerting them. That works too.
Turgle would introduce himself as not only an adventurer, but also a bard, particularly a poet. During battle, on his turn, in addition to attacking, if he quotes a line from Edgar Allan Poe's The Raven, you guys would all gain an extra 1d4 damage on all your attacks.
Have we met before? Because in real life, I am actually related to Edgar Allan Poe.
I'm afraid not.
Okay. It doesn't mean I've read any of the books, but...
to quote the Raven, put me the fuck down.
Nevermore. I put him down.
You had him picked up?
I had him picked up.
Hilarious. I just got back, didn't hear any of that.
You know, he was, you know, messing with what was obviously a religious thing, so yeah.
To try and shove what rubies I was able to scavenge from that tablet into my bag.
You do so.
Hey, elf.
Hey, buddy, what's up?
Hey, you planning on selling those rubies?
What rubies?
The ones you took from the statue. I like what rubies.
Statue? I don't see a statue. I don't know what you're talking about. Are you drunk? You're drunk.
he is.
I'm always drunk.
You need to calm down.
You can see him slurring a bit.
All right, like, chill out. Look, I gotta... Hey, it's okay.
Well, it will be okay. I can translate that rubies to silver for you if you want. I'd say I will give you a 10% above the normal price.
I'm not quite sure I believe him, so I'm just gonna kind of scurry around and ignore.
Sounds good.
I'm gonna come back to him, and I'm gonna say, it's dangerous out here, and I don't know why you're out here, except for obviously profit. But I am not leaving you out here where orcs and batshit crazy people might come. You are going to be coming with us because come by.
You're interrupted by the packs who say, we must hurry. Orcs, this is orc territory. We all must go. And you see them start to wander off.
Well, I quickly accept your offer as a sellsword.
Are you going to make them pay you?
Pay them with literature and poems and... Gold for the soul.
Excellent. Half share for the thief. Let's go.
Half share. Okay.
As we walk onward, don't we need those antidotes?
How do I go about moving?
I'm sorry. You want to click on your character and click and drag? You can click and drag your character. Perfect. You can control everyone's character, but that's true about everyone in you. So, try not to do that.
Do I have to roll the move?
No, that's no. Silly. we play by the rule of cool in this game. If you want to do some, just say you want to do it, and we will find a way for you to do it. Given, if you say, like, I want to run up the wall and backflip, that's going to be hard for a dwarf, and it'll probably end in your neck being snapped. So, rule of cool. As you walk through this area, you can see it's just completely dilapidated. Very poor condition.
What are we searching against onward?
We are looking for Agrimar's Bane.
Oh, yes, of course. This gnome beer is so good.
They point kind of northward.
Kind of northward, okay.
Yeah. As you kind of look over, you start to see, in addition to the flames, you see like pikes, and you start hearing chit-chat from orcs.
Oh, great.
You think you've hit orc territory.
We think. There's five of them. Oh, that's great.
They say if we're quiet, we can sneak past.
If we are quiet, we have two people for
In addition, you can see these guys. They're being quite loud and they're talking, and there's a light there, so their vision would be poor past here. Okay. It would take a low check to succeed. As long as you don't get natural ones, you should be fine.
I would like to first turn my light off.
Of course. The pecks kind of grab each of your hands as they try to guide you through. Everyone except Brunar, who has dark vision. Although he can hold on to one of their hands for fun if you'd like.
Alright, and we're going to try to do stealth, which cool. Is great.
Everybody roll a dexterity check.
I just accidentally tripped over the dwarf. So small and hard to see.
Roll again, Brunar.
0. Just.
So Zanwart's not looking good. Brunar's doing great. So's the elf. Yeah, that's a half. And if you want, you can roll Targal. It'll be 1d20 plus 3 for you.
What is 3 dependent on?
It is on dexterity. And your dexterity is. Oh, it would be 1d20 plus 1. Cool.
Maybe this
yeah, beautiful. You guys all managed to sneak down this way.
Down. Okay.
Yeah. That's so they kind of guide you through.
And peek around the corner.
You peek around the corner and you find a familiar and unsettling area.
Oh yay!
But you do find it empty of undead orcs.
That's perfect.
Although,
fight them again.
Yeah. Although, Thyros notices some orc footprints traveling back and forth. Yeah. They seem relatively fresh.
I say they may still be patrolling here.
Then let us be swift.
We're not gonna kill orcs again, dammit.
Oh yeah, way too familiar.
Sandward, you always take me to such nice places.
I always try and impress a date.
At least it has candlelight.
Bruno doesn't realize that.
By the way, I might want to turn my light back on.
Oh yeah, I imagine you would have the moment you were out of danger. We say continue south.
Okay.
Here. Yeah, they say we're almost there. And they warn that do not attack the elementals. They are psychically or magically connected. And if you strike at one of them, they'll all strike at us.
This would be very bad. Very, very bad.
They nod.
Yep, they want to stay away from the barricades.
Let's go back to you. It is at this point that you guys see something called an elemental. Yeah, from these narrow halls, you eventually see a creature. It looks at you, it's this large hulking piece of rock. And as it sees you, it begins to charge. And go kill you. As they do, this one of them steps forward and kind of holds his hand forward. And as it kind of gets to you, it kind of starts to slow down, start walking, and you see him just kind of walk past you.
Okay.
They say Ogremark's Bane will not be as easy.
Excellent. We didn't think it was going to be.
Yeah. You see him. You see him kind of gather up, and they sort of form a circle.
Hey, weaklings, you might want to go into the circle. So, which way now? South or west?
I'm going to make one more. They start moving the circle.
I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay. Uh-oh.
Where'd he go?
One of you flew somewhere.
He just used his stealth
ability. Classic. Great. I don't know where he is.
He criticaled.
That wouldn't be there. I'm just going to go ahead and sigh. And I'm going to have to go. I'll go grab his other one. Copy of you.
Sorry about that.
It's okay. Just know that you can never come back to my game now.
It's okay. I think because of the last game and not taking damage, he's trying to kill me.
I'm trying to kill all y'all. That's my goal here.
Well, can I be excluded like I died
No.
two times yesterday?
What's your AC there and HP, William?
Oh, hold up a second, let me check.
Rename this Turtle. Your AC is 11. Well, I don't know why your character's not wearing armor. Your AC is HP is 7, okay. So your HP would your AC would be about 14. 14 AC and 7.
Cool. Oh, I have a lantern. Can I turn that on?
Oh, definitely. You kind of.
I have leather armor in my inventory, but it says.
Yeah. That would take you to about 14. You turn a lantern on, and you guys have now two lights. And as you do, this area is much more illuminated until you can see about the following. You can see the areas being worked by the elementals. These guys kind of move a protective circle around you and move you forward.
All right.
And they say he should be in the center. They kind of warn that he will be quite deadly. Blah, 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 blah. Yeah, they're not sure. They say you might be able to talk to it, but they don't know.
I don't think that's going to be really an option. I think
maybe I should even talk.
You kind of get to this point where you see this large kind of stadium or large dais. That would be it. Yeah. And you just see the gravel all over the place. This area is being worked. You can see the roof just goes up forever, like every other place in the underground.
Hey, where's that big candle anyway?
What's that?
Bruiner asks, where is that big elemental anyway?
As Bruiner says that, you begin to see rocks and gravel start to move around and swing into a circle. Hold on one second, I'll put on some.
I mutter under my breath, gravel elemental. Gravel.
Yeah. You start to hear a dull rumbling. Like stones rolling across the cavern's floor. The low, narrow passage opens, revealing... no, that's not right. Where are you? You see pebbles start to float in the air, Calissan spinning into a cloud of debris. Clouds gather in shape and form into a bloated, humanoid mass. This thing. You could see the cloud gathers to form. Glittering black stones begin to form and serve as eyes as they swivel into airy sockets. You see its large rock maw opens and it roars, "Who dares enter my domain?" And then it kind of looks down at you and says, "Kneel. Kneel before me, you insignificant mortals, or face my wrath." It just kind of lurches over top of you.
Okay, without asking Boyanir, are we actually going to try this charismatically, or are we just going to try to beat it to death?
Bruiner takes a knee, still holding his great axe on his right hand.
Cool. Bruiner's taking a knee.
Watching Bruiner, the guy that wants to kill everything, take a knee, I will also take a knee, but I still have my warhammer and my shield out.
Cool. Turgle and Zythos.
I somewhat puzzled. I'm pretty sure the mission was to kill this thing. So I say, are we elves or are we men and dwarves?
I have no clue what's going on, so
sorry. Decide and throw magic missiles at it.
Cool.
Guess we'll roll an initiative.
Yep, roll for initiative.
Ba-ding! 10.
Beautiful. As this guy, as you attack, this guy begins to make a swirling... The swirling rock begins to bombard you. All of these guys make a small protective bubble around yourselves.
And of course the wizard is in the bubble.
Yeah. So Bruiner, Turgle at 16, beautiful.
Bruiner is at 18.
18?
Yeah.
Beautiful. Cool. I believe that our good friend Thyros tried to go first by sending out a magic missile. So that just automatically hits. Roll me 3d4. And you can also describe what kind of missiles come out, like the shape, and you can make like a big hand or like a bullet.
I send the four winds after this terrible beast.
Sweet. So you don't really see anything. You just see like small leaves just kind of rumble and move. It's like an invisible blast as you deal 10 points of damage to this monstrosity. So that means, Bruiner, you just saw this guy attack, and he roars out, and, everything kind of goes dark, just because there's so much rubble. You can manage to see within the bubble. And Thyrus can see himself.
Uh,
Does Tharos claw or something?
Yeah, Tharos is gonna take... He's gonna take 1 point of damage just from being bombarded by all the stuff out there.
Are these little guys we have small enough that I could charge through a space of them, like here, and attack?
I'm gonna go ahead and say yes.
And that's what I'm doing.
Cool.
And there's the attack rolls.
11. His AC is... oof. You lucky. That's really... I'm pretty sure it's exactly 11.
Really?
Perfect.
Yeah, looks like it's 11.
Somehow, I finally hit something.
So, what weapon are you using? Your two-handed axe?
Yeah, my great axe.
Cool. Give me a roll.
Do I roll damage or...
Yeah, roll damage. Just... Another 11, sweet. You kind of start slashing through, but as you slash, you notice that it's kind of... You're mostly just hitting the winds and the gravel.
Yeah.
Turtle! You're watching this giant elemental kind of surround you.
Do I have any, like, buffs for the party?
Well, if you would like to recite some poetry.
Does it have to be the raven? Because, most of his shit ends in death.
You can read whatever poetry you like.
Can I sing a song?
You can sing a song, but you would have to sing it.
I'm seeing you got the power while pointing at Brunor.
Sweet. Bum, go ahead.
Bum, bum, bum. You got the touch. You got the power.
Okay,
Do we still have that axe?
Yeah, Turgle started singing, so now he'll be singing during his turn, as well as fighting. Tharos. You notice your sexy really dark out there, so you can't see a lot. But you do see this large glowing bubble form.
Do I think that my gust of wind or anything like that would dispel this darkness?
I think you think that your wind might be able to defeat his wind. Especially with the gravel flying over the place, he might be able to do some good amount of damage.
I feel like I'm missing some really lowbrow humor here, but yes, I will use my wind to dispel his wind.
Oh, no. It is not lowbrow. This is not South Park here. Although that is a good show.
I agree to disagree.
So I summon up a mighty wind.
I agree with him, that's agreeing to disagree.
Okay, so that means he has to roll against your intelligence plus your modifier. He's going to try to do a constitution check, which because he's gravel, he has a good amount. He has to beat a 3 plus 1 plus 8. Yeah, so that would be 12. Unfortunately, he just does... He's two altogether. You do manage to push him low a little bit. He ends about there.
Okay. Can I move back into the bubble?
You can. You sure can. However, it's on your turn. While still outside, you take 4 points of damage.
Nasty.
That puts you at 1 point of health remaining. You come in just bloodied and looking horrible. Zanmark.
I'm spent.
Alright, so... Is he ranged? Is the giant orc behemoth ranged?
The giant monster is yet to attack. But but currently you're being blinded because there's so much gravel surrounding you.
Alright, well, I'm gonna assume that if I'm standing here and then Brainier comes up, that Tharos, as long as he stays in the bubble, probably won't get hit. And I'm going to use one of my cantrops. I'm going to use Sacred Flame.
Sounds good.
The target must make a Dexterity saving throw.
He's not good at that. You got a zero.
He is really not good at that. So
yeah, I'm going to count that as a crit.
Okay. That's 8 damage. It's 1d8.
Cool. So that means 8 plus plus another 1d8. So roll 1d8 plus 8. You would. I believe he's weak against something.
But I don't think it's radiant.
No, it is radiant. It's Sacred Flame's radiant damage.
Well, I was saying I don't think he's weak against radiant. Probably like cool. Water.
So yeah, you deal 9 points of damage, and you see it actually particularly burn him hard.
Yay. Alright, let's see what he's got.
Cool. You see him begin slamming against this the bubble. Eventually it kind of knocks a rock in and it kind of slams against you there, Zanlord.
Alright.
You got a natural 20. You got 20. Unnatural. Does 3 points of damage on you.
Okay, I can take it.
Brunar.
I guess I'll use my turn to drop my great axe and switch to my magic card axe, which now I remember I had.
Yeah, you kind of throw it out this way and you see it get picked up by the wind and start twirling around.
No, I dropped it on my...
okay, sure. I was trying to be cool, but whatever.
No. I don't want my great axe coming on my head again.
Would have been sweet though. I keep forgetting. Turtle's singing, so everybody who did damage roll an extra 1d4. Because you get an extra 1d4 for all damage because he's singing.
You're welcome. A 3.
Nice. A 3 does an extra 3 points of damage.
Not rolling since I didn't do.
No, you did actually. You did do damage. You attacked, remember? You just.
I thought my damage was not successful.
Was not as effective.
The witch did say use magic, which I know is not your expertise.
And Tharos, roll 3 1d4s. Ooh. Because you sent out 3 blasts, so 3d4. Oh, cool. Turtle, you're still singing. Give me another line, even though it is playing over.
Another line from the same song, or
oh yeah. I mean, I'm assuming you're able to hear the song playing.
I don't know anything else on the song.
That's okay. So yeah, you begin blasting. What do you want to do?
I inspire myself to take up arms. So.
Oh no, you're inspiring everybody. Yeah, your singing's making everybody like, yeah, we do have the touch, guys.
Can I throw my lantern at him so we'd be able to see him?
Interesting. I like it. Give me a roll using your dexterity.
You can help me out there. I have no clue what to do.
Alright, so d20 plus your dexterity.
Oh, you gotta say, yeah, that music's really loud.
Oh, is it loud?
I turned it down. So I roll a 20 plus my dexterity?
Exactly. This is not... I guess this is kind of attack, isn't it?
Alright, 16.
Okay, now who can guess what kind of effect this would have?
Well, if it's got like oil inside, it might be... alchemical fire, maybe? I don't
know. Oh, no. It would definitely burn it, and definitely give you 1d6 for damage. Because that definitely hit. probably right.
Do I have any modifiers for it? Is it just a d6?
It's just gonna be 1d6 because it's kind of a makeshift attack. But yeah, it does burst all over him, and the following thing happens. You guys are kind of just surrounded by flame.
That is just excellent.
I did good.
Yeah, yeah. It is now swirling and kind of burning all of you.
That's nice.
Everyone, please give me constitution checks to ward against the flame, the hot flame. Zanbar, you're going to take... how much damage did you take? You're going to take 4 points of damage.
Okay.
Bruno's fine. I'm afraid, Dungeon M, you take 4 points of damage and you go unconscious. The heat is just too much for you. In addition, roll me 1d20 there. I'll roll 1d20 for you. Because this is more my role. This is how badly you're getting hurt. Ho! So yeah, your hair gets on fire, and your head is badly burnt. Not exactly, not your beautiful elf hair. Of your conditioner, it seems to light up even further.
And olive oil's good for the hair.
but you collapse to the ground, writhing in pain. Everyone else seems fine though. Except for Zanwar, who got burned.
Okay, hold on, I'll subtract that. Is 4?
Yeah.
Okay.
In addition, you can see this whole thing. These guys are also getting burned, and they do very poorly. The bubble you see falter very quickly, and each of you receive 1 point of damage.
Alright. Wait, each of them or each of us?
Each of you.
Okay. I got it.
And that's from flaming rocks hitting you. Turtle, way to go. Tharos, back to you. Give me 1d20. Which is a basic 1d20.
Did this do any damage to the giant stone dude?
Oh yeah, it did damage. He's on fire now, and he will continue taking fire damage. On his turn.
As will us.
As will you. Until you can figure out some way to get rid of him.
You a song. You can't complain.
He is currently still singing a song. You guys got the touch. You've got the power.
Yes, and the wizard was empowered down to his death.
Yeah, unfortunately, the wizard's having a lot of trouble. He's still on fire, and he's still screaming. Still bleeding. Zanwar.
Alright. I have 2 options. The first one is to get the wizard up, but if the wizard fails 1 constitution, he's back down. So I am going to use Cure Light Wounds on myself.
Awesome. Roll for health.
It's a d8 plus 2.
It's 2d8 plus 2.
Is it? I think it's...
Oh, it's 2d8. It's 2.
So I'm pretty much back at full health.
Oh yeah.
9.
And I assume you don't want to move. You see this guy begin to spin around. He takes some more damage. D6 exactly. Takes 1 more point of damage. As he begins to kind of spin around and walk around and start smashing. He sees the bard in there singing and he doesn't like him. He's gonna give him a smash on his head. He begins wildly attacking the bubble. You can see it start to falter. And eventually a rock gets through. Ho! Dealing 7 points of damage. Let's see, and it deals 1d20. Landing on his head, and you see his neck kind of, not snap, but it definitely twists in a way it's not supposed to. As he falls down to the ground.
That's a weird act.
Well, there are 2 new people.
Brunner.
A couple of questions.
What's that, buddy?
Yes, that guy moving out of my range is not causing an attack.
It's because he's in addition to being wind and it being very dark and fire blinding you. In addition, if you moved around, he would not take attacks from you because you have a bubble around you. Yeah. So neither of you are taking attacks from you.
Okay. Is there a way that I could attack through the flame just by extending my weapon?
Give me you can easily do that. You can attack from where you are in the bubble. You can, if you replace Nurgle, if you give me a strength check, that's sufficient. It would basically be as your movement, you just kind of kick him aside as you move into his space.
And yell, weaklings!
Classic Brunar. Yeah, it doesn't even take effort. You just move him, you just kind of give him a shove back with the back of your heel as you move him into his space.
And charge with my hand axe. By the way, my armor class should be 15 now because I'm using my buckler and one-handed axe.
So you grab your buckler and you put on you strap it to your arm, you grab onto a hand axe and you start attacking.
Yeah, that was the previous round to change weapons.
Cool.
So I should attack now.
Yeah, give me a tackle. Oh, a 20, beautiful. Give me some damage.
What was the hand axe again?
It would be 1d6 plus 1, plus your strength.
So that would make it plus 4, I guess.
Yep. You get 5 damage. Or 10. A massive rock you see seemed to try to fly towards you, and you just smash it into two with your mighty axe. Turgle, roll me 120.
Yep.
Just to see if you can get back up or if you're going to be actually wounded.
20, I get a critical.
That means you get to roll 1d6, and that's how much health you gain as you backflip back up.
Does that take up my whole turn, or can I still do something?
That was not your whole turn. So you back up. You can now attack if you like.
Are they still like missing a buff or what? Are they still getting buffed, or is that over?
Oh, it's over. You'd have to take your turn to use it again.
Yeah, go ahead. Buff them again. I scream that I am the god of hellfire. I bid them to learn.
Cool. You start singing again, or doing poetry, and everyone gets an extra 1d4 to attacks again. Thyros. Rolling 1d20. Get a 20 like your friend. Don't get a 1. Wow.
Okay.
He's starting to look seriously bad. You see you stop moving, and he stopped struggling against the fire, although he's still on fire. Zanwar.
Alright, how is the Earth Elemental doing, or can I even tell, because there's just so much shit going around?
Do you know anything about the Arcane?
No, I don't know anything. Alright, so I'm going to use Spare the Dying on the wizard. Get him up to 1 health.
You give a touch to the wizard, and you see him sort of gasp as he wakes up and it's still on fire.
This again, oh god, it burns.
However, you see him roll around while on the ground, and he manages to get the fire off him. He's still on the ground though. The elemental. He looks at Zanwar doing that, and he starts smashing against the thing again. How does it do?
No.
That was an attack. That was him attacking the bubble. You see that the bubble actually maintains itself quite well. However, a rock still manages to get past the defense. It's getting a 21, dealing 6 points of damage.
I am glad I healed myself. I got it.
As a large rock smashes against your legs. Brunar.
You don't need those anyway.
It's true. He doesn't.
Yeah. Brunar is gonna continue slashing at this weak elemental.
Cool. Beautiful, it's a hit. Remember, you get an extra 1d4, so you roll 1d6 plus 1d4 plus 1d8 plus 4.
So many rolls. Sorry for the being late, guys. What typing?
Nice. So, tinier rocks start. You see no large rocks flying, but all these tiny ones are swinging towards you, and you just start batting them away as they come, dealing a good point of good amount of damage to them. Turkle, you're now singing or reciting your poetry, but your hands are still free.
Can I draw? I want to draw my sword. I'm drawing cool. My sword.
You draw your sword.
That doesn't require full.
Nope, you can still attack. That was your movement.
Alright, I'm going to run up to him and slash him. Yeah, that's all I'm going to do.
There's not a lot of space. Although he is kind of on top of you, he's rather large.
Can I grapple?
Are you going to try to grapple a giant rock monster?
Well, I am pretty acrobatic.
I will say go for it, and I can't wait for this to go wrong.
Alright, I'm going to try and grapple his arm. It's close enough.
Cool. Give me a grapple check against him.
Alright. You gotta tell me what to roll.
You would roll your strength. One d20 plus your strength.
So just a d20.
Yeah, oh, yeah, looks like it. As you attempt to grab onto a giant rock monster. Nice. You yell to the guys, I got this. You sort of jump out of the bubble and grab onto a large moving rock, who then starts floating out and you get thrown out of this thing.
What? I just get immediately thrown?
Well, no, you're still attached to the rock. You're just over here now.
Whee!
As it sort of flies off. Yeah, you're in the storm and you take 1d4, 3 points of damage.
Alright.
Making you unconscious.
Am I still
again.
Singing?
No. So
where's my body go? Does it just go flying or?
It starts to circle around within the flaming stuff. The fire starts to simmer down actually. Although he does take one last 1d6. He does take one last bit of fire damage. But the fire is now simmered down. You can see again. Well, you can see it better, but not that much better. Okay, and during this, every now and then you see the bubble starts getting bombarded by Turgle. His body.
Cow.
Thyros, what's up?
I attempt to use the wisdom of the great wizard Spartacus, and I cast Cold at the heated rock monster.
Nice.
Ray of Frost, please.
Cool. Give me 1d20 plus 4. I want you to roll the d20. Turkle, keep doing that. 10. Unfortunately, you're blasting wildly trying to hit the superheated rocks, but you just can't hit any of them. They're just too small and too fast. You do manage to hit Turkle a few times.
I was about to say that.
Zanvard, you're up.
Alright, so I get 3 cantrips a day.
No, you get infinite cantrips a day.
Oh, I could have sworn it said.
You get 3 level 1 spells per day.
Okay. Then I am going to use. I may have made my character wrong then.
No surprise there, but that's okay. We're just having fun here.
No, you know what? I want to go bash him with my Warhammer.
Cool. You're going to try to slam, destroy rock. With a 22, nice. Not quite a natural 20. So you see a rock come in, and it kind of just comes perfectly in line with your hammer. You give it a good smash, but you see it kind of just stands there against your attack. And eventually it just kind of pushes past you. You don't feel like you did that much damage to it.
Okay, that didn't work well.
So yeah, and then you see you start pounding up against this thing again. He's gonna take his whole turn just to attack the bubble. When he got a 19, you see him just slamming against the bubble, and each of you take 3 points of damage as the bubble weakens and all the granite flies into the room.
So everyone but Boineer is down.
Awesome. Cool. So Brenner, you're the last one up. Everyone else is gone unconscious.
As I imagined, weaklings, and I imagine this.
And this is Thurgle still being thrown around.
I imagine this monster is soon to die under my axe, and I will attack him. Yes, or. Would you take a turn to wake up somebody?
You don't have the knowledge to be able to resurrect people who are so badly damaged.
So I cannot use second wind in this. I guess it takes full damage from magic weapon, so I keep attacking with my axe.
And that's cool. Give me an attack. Oh! As you swing in, you swing in overconfidently, your axe leaves your hand and starts flying around in the wind.
Great, so now we have two bodies and an axe flying
floating around, yeah. Turgle, roll me 1d20. Okay, yeah, you're back to zero, but of course you're also being bombarded, so you're still having a lot of trouble out here as you're slamming against this bubble over and over again.
So wait, am I still unconscious?
Yes, you are still very much so unconscious. Tharos, give me 1d20. I'm a star. Do you actually want to be out in the wind, or do you want to be down here in the bubble? Doesn't matter, you're still unconscious. Xanvar, 1d20. Also unconscious. And this big guy, he's gonna try to slam on Brunar again.
Bring it down.
As he kind of slams down, it does actually come through, but you kind of just dodge out of the way. And as you look down, you kind of smile as you see that your hand axe has been embedded in the piece of the rock.
So the hand axe is inside the circle now?
It is, yes.
That would be my move action.
It would be a strength. It would be a strength roll, trying to take it out of the rock.
Would that take up my entire turn?
It would. It would not. If you get a significant strength roll, it would not. If you get like a 5, I'll be like, you got out, but it didn't do. You didn't take a turn.
20 and
20. So be a strong dwarf.
Of course. What did you expect?
Beautiful. Yeah, you lift it up with your two hands, still attached to the rock, and you just slam it down, and it just shatters the rock in two. And then you kind of just look up to this thing, and you start attacking.
By saying, hey, thanks, I needed that.
Terrible. You start.
Yes, I don't have the bonuses, right?
No. I will let you use an inspiration die though for being the last one. You can roll me another 1d4 for being the lone survivor in this really
mess. I'm the hero.
Yeah. This is Brunner's story.
And he's carrying the weaklings around.
Perfectly enough to hit him. So roll damage.
That would be 1d6 plus my strength plus 1 from the axe.
5 points of damage. Nice.
Nice.
Yeah. You can see as you smash against that one of those rocks, you see him sort of roar out in a pain. His body seems to collapse on the bubble. He definitely still seems alive, but you can see his head with those two black. Onyx rocks his eyes. kind of just leering over top of the bubble as he's using it for support. Turgul, Thyros, Zanbar, give me 1d20s. Unfortunately, all of you are doing quite poor, except for William, who Turgul still didn't get 20. Brunner, he's got. You have to get a natural 20 to jump back up. But otherwise, you're. Well, with your roll, you actually land floop back inside. You kind of land on Zanwar and use him for cover. The rock monster starts bashing against the thing, but he can't get through. You see him just fruitlessly smashing and bashing against the sides, but he's just too weak to get through. And Bruno, you have a clear shot to him.
And trust the dwarf fighter to attack.
With a smash, you rip through his face, tearing his head in two. His two onyx eyes fall through the bubble and land beside you.
Is it dead?
Yeah.
Whee!
You hear a roar, a final roar from him as he roars in pain.
And I take out one of my water skin with beer and pour it on Brunor in an attempt to wake him up.
You are Brunor.
Zanward.
After a moment, Zanward wakes up in a shock. He looks around and sees the bubble dispersed and just surrounded by granite.
And apparently beer as well.
Indeed.
I stand up, and the first thing I notice, besides the fact that I'm drenched in beer, is that we still have two people down, and I'm going to play favorites, and I'm going to get the wizard up first.
Sweet. So we cut to a portrait. It's of all of the, what's that? It contains all of these little guys kind of standing in front of you. You can see Turgul and Thyros in the background, the Zanward kind of trying to heal them. And Brunner kind of holding these two black orbs in his hand, just with his big smile going, ha 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 ha.
Oh, could they change that?
Oh, sure. How would you want to do?
As the others pose, the dwarf would be clenched down, searching for loot once again.
The two things, the two eyes, are most likely large black gems. So you holding those up, like, I have these two gems now.
Yeah.
And that's the game, gentlemen.
Yay!
Still those rocks from.
You would return to Zanaka. She would appreciate the work you've done. You see all these elementals disperse, most likely returning to the elemental plane they came from. The boon is intact. The pecs are very appreciative to you. Mission well done.
Yay!
It's fun. Thank you very much for your game, DM.
Thank you guys for playing. I've been the Bumble Rumble.